Discover how you can green your life by building a knowledge base of current sustainable and eco-savvy trends. This series will delve into hot topics, current standards and practices, ways to design better spaces, and specify materials that benefit not only us as consumers, but the world as a whole. Members of CaraGreen, as sustainable materials distributors, and other industry leaders weigh in throughout the series. This is Build Green, Live Green.
Hi, this is Jessica with Build Green, Live Green, the podcast by CaraGreen. Today we have a special guest with us, Sarah Healey from Casella. And forgive any slight interruptions that may occur due to dogs barking and things like that. That's the new podcast reality. But Sarah, welcome to Build Green, Live Green.
Thanks. Thank you so much for having me.
So Sarah is here. We actually had Joe from Casella on a prior podcast, and we were just so excited about the scope of what Casella actually does. When you think of a traditional waste management, you guys go so far beyond that. And Sarah herself is a true zero waste advisor, which is a person who is able to kind of conduct the certification, which is a GBCI program. So can you talk a little bit about Casella and their scope and what your role is? And then tell us a little bit more about, you know, you work specifically with a lot of universities in the New England area. So we'll get to all that fun stuff, but can you kind of give us the overall look of Casella and how broad their scope is?
Yeah. So Casella is a fully integrated resource management company, which is a lot of jargon, but basically what it boils down to is that we're not your typical waste hauler. We go above and beyond just servicing trash and recycling. We have specialty recycling programs. We run special organics operations, and we also work with colleges, universities, manufacturing, and industrial sites to help them solve their waste challenges, which is really how Casella moved into the True Zero Waste Advisors and helping support our customers achieve their goals around that.
So let's, you know, when we talked to Joe, he was talking about how you guys would go into a corporation, like a commercial business, and really help them manage their waste. I would imagine that universities have, you know, a different issue, not only because they're not, because of the people that frequent the university being, you know, kids that just left home where mom used to clean up after them, but it's, you know, that's a very disposable society too. So what are some of the challenges that are kind of unique and inherent to, you know, universities and colleges?
Yeah, I think what is so unique about the colleges and universities are that there are so many people that interact with the waste system. So if you think of a manufacturing site, everything is confined into that single building or a series of buildings. But on a college and university, you have visitors, you have sporting events, you have dining facilities, people who live there, people who don't. And all of those things make it a really unique challenge for solving the zero waste and waste challenge. But in addition to that, some of these colleges and universities are massive. They're small cities within a city like Boston, and you look at how much they take up and you think about how many buildings they're building, how many renovations they're doing. And over time, it really adds up to a lot of material that they're looking to move off their campus in a sustainable way.
So, you know, from CaraGreen's perspective, you know, we do a lot of work with universities and we've seen them kind of embrace LEED building specifically, but, you know, certainly there's other standards out there as well. What can you talk a little bit about true zero waste? Because zero waste is kind of, you know, this utopian idea, and people have kind of played into that, like with circularity and take back programs and things like that. But true zero waste, it kind of tacks on this implication that people are using zero waste erroneously and it's not actually true zero waste. So can you talk about how that certification came about and why?
So for true zero waste, the zero waste concept is really broad and kind of impossible to achieve. So what True looked to do is build a system that was achievable and had set items that you had to meet to be able to get certified as True Zero Waste. And similar to the LEED certifications, they have various tiers that you can achieve. So it makes it a challenge for people, but it also sets reasonable expectations. For the True Zero certification, you have to hit 90% diversion. What it's looking to do is also incorporate credits to make sure that you're incorporating recycled content into the products that you're buying and looking at your supply chain and things like that.
So when you talk about diversion, you're talking about waste diversion. 90% of the waste that of the project is diverted from landfill to a,
Yes. Okay. So for diversion, the formal definition is any materials that can go into a recycle, reuse, reduce program divided by any materials that go to a landfill, incinerator, or are just dumped on the side of the road.
Got it. And I love to hear the idea of incorporating materials with recycled content, because obviously that's a lot of the CaraGreen materials that we have. But it's a step in the right direction. You can't get there with one giant leap. You've got to take these baby steps. And it sounds like True Zero Waste is really enabling those steps in the right direction. And when you cut it into smaller chunks, it becomes a lot more manageable. I did have a question about one thing you said, an observation that turns into a question. You said reduce, reuse, recycle. And I think that people know the terminology, but they don't realize that that's in order, right? So first reduce the amount of material that you're using, then reuse what you can, and then ultimately recycle. So are all of those things kind of in the overall ethos of True Zero Waste, and how?
Yeah, so I think that True did a really great job of building those into the credit system. So for the reduce, you can get various credits for tracking the actual amount of reduction in your waste generation that you have. And they do this by having a baseline that you track against. So you can see, okay, in 2019, we had 10 tons. Now we have 5 tons. We know that we've reduced that amount, and then we've also recycled or composted other things for this other material. So I think that they really capture that through the credit system and tracking to the baseline, which makes it so that you can actually see the holistic picture of what's going on and encourage people to go beyond just recycling. What we learned from the recycling crisis from a few years ago is that you can't recycle your way out of the problem. We have to go bigger and think more strategically about the problem.
Yeah, and we've done podcasts in the past where we've covered just how poorly a lot of people understand recycling. You know, they see a triangle on a flimsy plastic bag and it goes in the recycling bin. I mean, I find myself kind of picking things out. So I think there's a lot of education that needs to happen, but to see this being implemented in higher education, I think is really promising for just the overall understanding of you know, waste management and mitigating the amount of waste that's out there, and certainly repurposing things. You know, I think, you know, that's another, there's just so much room for growth here. And I think this ideal vision of circularity, right, where, you know, I always liken it to someone walking into a building that's being torn down with a barcode reader, and every time they scan a barcode, it sends a message to, you know, whoever, and they come and they dismantle it and they take it away. So this is, you know, kind of this utopian idea of circularity, and True Zero Waste is a, you know, the kind of small stairwell, you know, to get you there. Can you talk about a little bit about, you know, take back programs? Because I see there's a lot of just shortcomings there. Like, there's this idea that you can take my carpet back, but what if I glued it down with some VOC laden adhesive? What do you kind of guidance does True Zero Waste, or what kind of requirements does True Zero Waste have there?
So for True Zero Waste, I think that take back programs can be really great because they are a way to get material back to the program. And it's very similar to like the EPR regulations that we see being proposed. But the challenge of it is when it actually comes down to it, when push comes to shove, you do find glue in places that you didn't expect, or you find cement around rebar that can't be separated. And what True does is they build out the supply chain of the recycling market, which is something we don't typically think of, but it's all of the upstream. It's what's happening with the suppliers and how the procurement teams are purchasing, how the construction and capital projects teams are interacting with their vendors and looking at the architects and things like that to build out better programs. So like instead of a take back program, for example, you could build a program where the windows that you're going to put in this new building will match windows in other buildings. So maybe when this one needs to get replaced or it gets knocked down, you can move things and use them somewhere else on campus or somewhere else in the city. So I think that those are the types of programs that we'll see more in the future rather than take-backs, because the take-back programs have really had a hard time taking off and have not had a lot of success.
So one of the things, as you're talking about this, I wonder, you know, my barcode scenario, that my barcode has all the information I need to know what to do with that window. That may not be a reality for every building material. So what is the mechanism to, you know, how is it documented like LEED is? Is it pretty document intensive so that there's a handbook? So it's like the demolition handbook, or how is that documented?
Yeah, so LEED has an entire documentation program very similar to LEED, where you have to track all of your different items and have to write information about each one and show the various projects that you took on to achieve that credit. But I think that that's one of the big challenges of the construction side of it, at least, is that tracking waste materials from a construction project or a renovation is really challenging. You have multiple vendors, they're usually not managed by the university, they're managed by the contractor or the architecture company. So you have all these stakeholders involved that make it really challenging to capture the information you need to improve the program.
Yeah, and you mentioned two parties, architects and contractors, who have very different levels of embrace for some of these sustainability programs. So architects, I mean, I kind of envision this almost like are you familiar with BIM and building information modeling?
No.
Okay, so BIM, which is building information modeling, it's basically like, you know, 3D models of buildings where you're instantiating different materials, where I think this is a great, you know, True Zero Waste could integrate into that environment pretty well. And I think, you know, eventually here it will, but you can render things and it'll find errors, like maybe this wall is not in the right place, or if you do this, then X, Y, and Z are going to happen. You're going to have to rip it all out. And maybe you wouldn't have seen that on the drawings, but it's rendering those things and catching it beforehand. So it's eliminating a lot of construction waste that would have happened due to design errors or construction errors. So BIM, I can see the architects really getting into True Zero Waste because they can build that into, you know, these 3D models. But contractors, they are not always on board with these sustainability, you know, ideas, and you know, they're trying to get something done quickly so they can go on and make money at the next thing. So I feel your pain because we run into that every day. But I do wonder, True Zero Waste as a program, do you feel like the university involvement is going to draw attention to it and propel it into the commercial space?
I think so. The True program has actually been very much in the industrial and manufacturing setting. Kind of similar to what I said at the beginning, is that you have so much control over the inputs and the outputs of the materials, so you have a lot more ability to make progress there. And I think that the colleges are finding it as a useful tool, but their goals are 5, 10, 15 years out, whereas the manufacturing facilities are 2, 3, 4 years out.
Yeah.
So I think we're beginning to see that progress, but I think it'll be a little bit before we see it go into some of the smaller commercial settings, like the restaurants and areas like that.
Well, I'm excited to hear about it. I'm excited to talk about it and promote it. And, you know, I let's stay in touch and keep us posted on how things are going at the universities. You're the first True Zero Waste advisor that I've ever spoken to, so I'm very pleased to have had this time to talk with you.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. I love to talk about waste and True Zero, so it's very exciting to be able to speak with you today.
Well, thank you. And no dogs or kids interrupted us, so this is a win for me. So thanks again, Sarah. This is Jessica with Build Green, Live Green.